Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today, I'd like to show some new developments, not very Android-related, but in the Android wish, so in the opposite direction. So my first try in the beginning of 2019 was to try to make a new video driver for SDL. And I found a project which is called jsmpeg.com. You can find it on GitHub, which basically uses some development from Nokia. I think Nokia did some work which implements an MPEG decoder in JavaScript. So given that we have browsers which have a JavaScript engine which translates to machine code, you can have some decent performance. You can have frame rates of about 30 to 60 hertz for not very large videos. And this website has some great demos. The first one is a video player which plays back a video stream. The second one shows something resembling VNC, where you project a desktop using an MPEG codec, and the display is made by the browser with a JavaScript-based MPEG decoder. And the next piece of motivation was the Cloud TK, which you saw on the Tickle Wiki, which takes another approach using an ex-VNC server. And the NoVNC.com JavaScript-based VNC player to have a desktop or a TK application in the browser. But I wanted to have it integrated in one binary, so I tried to integrate the JSMPEG in form of a new SDL video driver in order to have the Android wish sending data via WebSockets to a browser which displays it using JavaScript. So what's needed? One needs parts of the FFmpeg libraries for the codec. One needs some WebSocket facility. There's an open source WebSockets library. One needs some JavaScript for the MPEG decode, and one needs some JavaScript for the opposite direction, make mouse events, make keyboard events. And then you need an Internet Explorer, a new one, a Firefox, Chrome, or Safari. And all is prepared to have an Android wish displayed in the browser. So let's try it. With my demo I showed last year, maybe you remember, it's exactly the same code as last year. Including the video capture. And it runs in the browser. I even can zoom it. And we can do now the field test. If I enable my wireless LAN hotspot here, then you should be able to connect on this from your laptops. Shall we try it? Okay. So, can you read the password? And the network name? IBOX. IBOX. All small letters. The password is all caps JA2P0XVB. And the IP address is 10, this one. Oh, sorry. JA2P0XVB. And the IP is? Yes. And you should connect to this IP on port 8080. And now let's see if my laptop explodes. Please move some. Thank you. Please move the mouse, Richard. Yes, it has about, I think, 25 frames per second, and you have the round trip time.
Yeah, we're all fighting each other.
Yeah. So, may I ask, how many people are now seeing this on their laptops? 2, 3, 4, 5. So, 6. We have 6 WebSocket sessions now running simultaneously. This is an i5. Dual-core laptop running here. And the performance isn't that bad. Okay. Thank you. So I'll close this now, and let's go on. How is it made? The left part of this diagram is what already is implemented in an Android Wish or in an Android Wish. And the new stuff is on the right side. So we have basically one function, which is in SDL speak, the pump events function, which services the WebSocket for sending data out to the browser or receiving things if you move the mouse or if you press a key, which starts an encoding process and which sends out finished encoded frames via WebSockets. And in order to gain from multicores, I did the encoding in a separate thread. So I have some coordination between this function and a separate encoder thread, so in order to have at least 2 cores simultaneously working for smaller devices. That's all. Okay. Working is it on Linux, Windows, Mac OS with some limitations. There I did no efforts to enable OpenGL yet. And in theory, it should run on the BSDs too. What's included? You saw the multi-threaded stuff. All SDL2 supported input things should in theory work. This means with a little effort, even joysticks should be able to be integrated, because I think at least Firefox has some joystick interface from the JavaScript level, but that's not yet done. And as usual, I tried that almost everything which works on a normal desktop environment also works in this environment. And the cost is overall 120 kilobyte, including the JavaScript stuff, including the video driver stuff, which is added if you build a static library of TickleTK for Android Wish. Okay, so my goal was to have it on the Pi Zero. This failed because the Pi Zero is too slow. Pi 3 with 4 cores is almost usable, and I hope that the new Pi 4 will have now decent performance comparable to a laptop. So it works on the Pi 3, but it's even more sluggish than you observed. Okay. That was the JS MPEG stuff. I did some little more. Wait. Okay. What can be done alternatively? We could use libvnc server, but the problem is it has to be integrated in the video driver. SDL is not GPL, Tickle is not GPL, but libvnc server is. So this might be a problem. Another approach would be free RDP. It's not clear for me how their licensing is, and I know of no RDP-based client which can be integrated in a web browser. Or one could do another approach like CloudTK, or what's implemented, by the way, in GNOME with Broadway. Did anybody ever try it out? GNOME is able to do a very similar thing, and it's even, I think, even better, but it requires some daemon, like an X server, which does the translation from GTK or glib calls into some transport, which in turn displays something in the browser. But it's, I think it's very advanced yet. But the approach is similar to X, which means you have to run a Broadway daemon, which transports stuff to the web browser. Okay, then the next experiment was I found that little TK VLC from a guy in Taiwan, Ray 2501, and I contributed a little bit to his code in order to use the VLC media player to put its video stuff on a photo widget, which means we can use it in Android Wish, which you know isn't X11 or Windows system based, but uses SDL as render engine. So I can use the VLC media player component also in Android Wish. And there I have a demo where we use the 3D canvas from Richard. And project some music video on a cube, on 4 cubes. So the playback is done using the libvlc, which puts its frames in a photo widget. The photo widget is taken as a texture on a 3D canvas. And we can do this, of course, using the JS MPEG video driver, because I have here a Linux system, and because I managed it, that I also can do OpenGL using this JS MPEG driver. Let's see it. So if you open your browser windows again, you should see now this. Oh, it's very slow. I should start it in a smaller window. Just a second. Not in full screen mode, but in some smaller. Let's reconnect. It's sluggish. Please try it by reconnecting. And it now projects things using the JS MPEG driver. Using WebSockets, using JavaScript. So the display is made using JavaScript, decoding an MPEG stream. Okay. So far, so good. I think the next thing we skip, or would you like to hear something about OPC UA? Would you hear something like? Okay. OPC UA is the follower of OPCDA. It's a standard for machine-to-machine communication. It's about 10 or 12 years old, used for process control, automation, and so on. And like its predecessor, OPCDA, it models some process in form of an address space where you have named stuff like variables, where you have objects which have methods, and so on. In some degree, it resembles web services, SOAP, and so on, but it's a binary transport. And it's a standard, which means that there are it's possible to make generic clients which can browse, which can, by introspection, learn how the address space is built up. And I found a project on GitHub, which is made by Fraunhofer in combination with some German companies, which is called Open 62541.org, and made based on their C implementation, a tickle interface. And there is some documentation on the androwish.org and their sample code on the tickle wiki. Just search for TOPCUA, for tickle OPCUA. And the demo is, for example, a little webcam, I think. The first version has about 100 lines of code, which uses parts of vanilla or Android Wish in order to read out the camera of your laptop, and which transports the image in form of a PNG as a variable in this OPC UA address space. So let me start the server. So the camera is now acquiring images, and now I start some generic, how is it called, process, OPC UA client. This is a client of a Finnish company. I think it's implemented in Java. I have to connect on localhost port 4840. And then I can see the address space of this server. This is my uacam.tickle. And you see here a directory of of objects. Within it is some folder called little webcam. This is my server, my little webcam server, which in turn has some variables, brightness, contrast, and so on, and a variable named image. And here we can see this is there's a data type here. Data type image. Images are some subclass of byte arrays, as far as I remember. And I even can open, I can show this variable, and we should see the camera image. Which is acquired by our server, which is written, I think, each 2 seconds into this variable, and which this client now can retrieve generically. And it's a generic client. The protocol defines the binary transport, and you can get some generic, for free, some generic clients from Prosys or from Unified Automation or whatever, and connect to the server and see the variables. Okay. Likewise, it's easy to make some Tickle client using the client side of the of this OPC UA interface. You find the code also on the Tickle wiki. That's the client. It does the same as I showed with the process. OPC UA browser, but now in Tickle. I think also 150 lines of code. It's very compact. Okay. Thank you. So now, but now for the for my work in progress, which is what I had should have shown in the first place, but it wasn't unclear if I get it ready until today. It's some rebuild of Jupyter notebooks, but with much less code. You know Jupyter notebooks? Who knows Jupyter notebooks? Many. So basically, it's some read-eval print loop of Python, which can be run in a web browser, where you need some web server, which connects to a Python interpreter, and you need the browser, and I want to have all in one thing. So the idea is, let's find some web view which takes the display component of browsers. There's a project on GitHub. The link is here. Let's see if there is if it's possible to make a Tickle interface. And ideally, this guy had a Python interface which was easily ported, and then build something around using Tickle and JavaScript in order to simulate Jupyter notebooks, and finally find a name for it. You see, this is Taygete, which is the 20th moon of Jupiter, which is, I think, a very small rock in space. But that was my intention, to have a very small thing which resembles Jupyter notebooks and which allows to enter Tickle interactively and see the result and have the possibility to print it or to make an HTML document out of it. So let's see how it works. I made a zip kit, you will see the link later, which basically starts this way. You can start a new document or you, let's see the cheat sheet. It's made very simple. It's no tricks regarding save interps. It's you hack on the main interp. You can shoot in your own foot. If you make an endless loop, then you have to use Control C to kill the process. But it began to work. There are some procedures which allow you to add simple HTML things like header lines or images. There are more complex things which I show next, which implement some kind of canvas widget without bind, but which allow to make from a canvas widget SVG and display it here in this document. So to show it how it basically works, let's enter some Tickle code. Shift return. Or let's add a headline. Or let's add an image. There are some helpers for using file dialogs. If I simply type img without a parameter, then I should get a file dialog box and choose Mary Poppins. Or let's make a table. -4 means use the first line of the Tickle list at the header line with 4 columns. And so on. So you have, I even can do package require TK. And have in parallel running a TK, full TK. That's where the problems will begin, because think of this is a Linux. This component is GTK, including WebKit, including JavaScript engine, and so on. And this is TK. So from now on, there can be heavy problems, but this is work in progress. Andreas.
Yeah. I was wondering, is this also something that can be shared among more machines? In case yes, then on which of the machines would the window actually appear?
No. No. It's this is no shared thing. This is running, this is a browser component. This is the WebKit GTK component in case of Linux. It makes its own top level, which is, let me say, maybe GNOME. I think it is GNOME. Yeah? In case of my setup here, my session runs with its GNOME on Wayland. This is even a Wayland window. It's not X, not X11. And you are isolated. So you have JavaScript, you have Tickle, you have some means how they communicate, but you can enter stuff interactively and you can play something like Jupyter Notebooks with it. And you can, of course, package require something which does even more. I'll show it. Maybe, wait, here. That's how the web view is instantiated. Would hide like a TK widget. Then we have a URL parameter, which could be a real URL, maybe google.com. But we want to have something within our small world. So it's more likely that this is a JavaScript URL in form of some very cryptic encoded URL format. Then we have on this object things in order to evaluate JavaScript code. And in the opposite direction from JavaScript to Tickle, there's exactly one call which invokes the callback here with a single string, which can be arbitrary everything. Yeah? And the trick of the Taigeti scrapbook is to have it bootstrapped, which means in the beginning on the construction of the web view, I have to add some JavaScript URL, which pulls in the rest of JavaScript in order to have the interactivity that finally, if you hit shift return on an input field, something is executed here, which evaluates in the Tickle world. And one can do funny things with it. For example, yeah. Okay, two examples, okay? Example one, where everything begins. I wanted to have the plot chart of IN. Therefore, I invented the canvas emulation, and I take some code, or some example code from RDN's plot chart widget and make an SVG, make a canvas of it. And this little call makes it into an SVG, which is displayed here. So I can re-evaluate it. It's filled with, as you can see here, with random data. So the next evaluation should change the plot. That was the first idea. The next test was, okay, let's make some SQLite. There's a port of the Northwind access demo, which is in a GitHub project, and some glue code in order to acquire this stuff from, okay, I should have some network connectivity that it can work. Now it should work. So I pulled the diagram, the schema diagram of this Northwind database out of the GitHub. And now let's do some queries on the data. I pull the database as SQL from the GitHub and pull out some table displayed here as HTML table. And I can even pull out the images, which are blobs in this database. Or if you look into the diagram, there's one employees table, which also has photos. So let's make another query. and pull out the images of the employee of the month of our fictive company. So it's running now on an in-memory database, which I pulled the SQL from GitHub and so on. And you can do it interactively, and you can, at least on Linux, say TSB colon colon print and make it into a PDF or send it to the printer. This document, the current state of this document. Or you can make a HTML copy, read-only copy of the document into a file for emailing it or something like this. Okay, that's all. You find the thing on... Thank you. You find this thing as a single zip kit on this URL. It's small, I think 500 kilobytes, and it should run on the major desktop platforms for experimentation. But this is work in progress. It will, of course, change in the next days, weeks, and months. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian.
Questions?
I think time's up.
Okay.
Sorry.
No problem. Machst du mich mal los? Ja.